A very good morning to my dear students. So today we are going to look for the absorption of drugs. So in case of pharmacokinetics, which include absorption, distribution, metabolism and excretion, out of which the first one is absorption. So what is absorption? So absorption is nothing but when the drug is administered. So from the site of administered, so how it enters into the bloodstream, and that is known as absorption. So absorption of the drug, in the sense, it is the movement of the drug from the site of administration and into the bloodstream, and that is known as drug absorption. So what are the factors which influencing the drug absorption? There are various factors which will influencing the drug absorption. What are the factors? The first and foremost, it is the physicochemical properties of the drug. Then the route of administration, pH and ionization, then the food, then presence of other drugs, that is the drug-drug interactions, and pharmacogenetic factors, and area of absorbing surface, and the gastrointestinal and other diseases. So these are the some of the factors which will affect the drug absorption. So how these factors are affecting the drug absorption, we will look into one by one. The first one is physicochemical properties of the drug, in which there are n number of factors are there, and at which I may give it to you. The first one is the physical state. So physical state of the drug, it is a physicochemical property of the drug. That is, what is the physical state of the drug? So the physical state, in the sense, the drug may be in solid form, the drug may be in liquid form, and drug may be in semi-solid form. Out of which, the classical information is, the liquid form of the drugs are always better absorbed when compared with than solid form. So what may be the reason, in the sense, I think you know very well, the disintegration time which may decrease, and thereby the absorption rate is increased. So that is the major reason why the liquid forms are much better absorbed than the solid form. So if you are thinking about the physical state which will affect the absorption rate. If the physical state of drug is liquid form, it is better absorbed when compared with than solid form. Then if you are thinking about the solubility, so there are two ways of the solubilities are available. One is water soluble drugs and lipid soluble drugs. And always the lipid soluble drugs are, that is majority of the time, it is in unionized form, or least ionization form. So the lipid soluble and unionized form of the drugs are always better absorbed when compared with an water soluble and ionized form of the drugs. Then next comes the particle size. So the particle size of the drug, if the smaller particle size of the drug, if it is available, it has the better absorption when compared with a larger particle size. So the particle size, the size of the particles, is plays a vital role in the rate of absorption. So classical example is the digoxin and the griseofalvin is well absorbed in the gastrointestinal tract. When you are, if you are thinking about the anthelmintics, usually the anthelmintics which has the larger particle size, and thereby the absorption rate is poor in the GID, right? So the disintegration time. So what is my disintegration time? The time taken for the formulation to break up into smaller particles. The disintegration time is the time taken for the formulation to break up into smaller particles. Okay, fine. If what happens with the disintegration time? If the disintegration time varies, it will affect the bioavailability. What is bioavailability? It is the amount of drug which reaches into the blood circulation. It's nothing but it is the biofactor of the absorption. So automatically, if the disintegration time varies, it will affect the absorption rate. Then next comes the dissolution time under the physicochemical properties. So dissolution time is the time taken for the particles get into the solution form. If the drug which has the shorter dissolution time, which has the better absorption rate. Then next comes the formulations. So the drug, in the sense, it is not only the active constituents. The drug which has the other additives or the pharmacologically inert substances, such as the starch, calcium sulfate, lactose. So these are the other pharmacologically inert substances are going to be the additives, or which can be added for the bind as an binding agents too. And these pharmacology inert substances, it is not totally inert. It also affects the rate of absorption. So classically, if I want to give it to you, the example, the calcium sulfate and the calcium, that which will reduces the absorption of tetracycline. So when the drug combined with the calcium along with the tetracycline or the calcium sulfate is an inert pharmacological inert substances, even though it is not totally inert. So the calcium present in the calcium sulfate, which will affect the absorption of tetracycline. The next comes the route of administration. So the route of drug administration, which will directly affect the rate of absorption. How? If you are giving into an intravenous route of administration, so normally the intravenous route of administered drugs, which won't enter into the absorption, normal process of the absorption, it won't enter, it directly enters into the blood circulation. So that the immediate actions is possible when the drug is given in an intravenous route. The action is faster. When the highly polar compounds are not absorbed in the GIT, majority of the time, I think already we had discussed, that is highly polar compounds are nothing but ionized compounds, the ionized drugs, which is not absorbed in GIT. So it has to be given in the parenteral route. The classical example is gentamicin. So gentamicin, it cannot taken into the oral absorption because it may not be absorbed in gastrointestinal tract. So you have to go with an parenteral route of administration for the better pharmacological absorption. And few drugs, it will be degraded in the GIT, gastrointestinal tract. Classical example is insulin. So insulin, you cannot take it into an oral administration because it is degraded in the gastrointestinal tract. It has to take taken only into the parenteral route. So like that, the route of administration is directly affecting the rate of the absorption. Then next comes the pH and ionization. I think ionized compounds, sure, it is going to have poor absorption. This is a core concept. Unionized drugs, which may have the highest absorption when compared with an ionization. So with that, the strongly acidic drug and the strongly basic drug, it is going to for as ionization at any pH. So strongly acidic acid in the sense heparin, the strongly basic drug in the sense aminoglycosides. Classical examples. And these drugs, it is ionized so quickly, so it has the poor absorption. Then next comes the food. The presence of food in the stomach, which will affect the absorption of the some of the drugs. The presence of food, which will affect the some of the drugs absorption. The classical example is rifampicin and levodopa. So rifampicin and levodopa, these drugs, which will be affected when the food is there in the GIT. That means the rate of absorption should be decreased. So automatically it has to taken on the empty stomach. So if the rifampicin or the levodopa, like these drugs have been prescribed, it has to taken in an empty stomach. And milk and milk products, which also decreases the rate of absorption of tetracycline. So whenever the tetracycline is given, the milk and milk product should not be given. Otherwise, the absorption of the tetracycline will be decreased by the milk and milk products. In sometimes the fatty meals, which may increases the absorption of glycosylphosphatidylserine. That means some of the meals which may increase, the classical example is the fatty meals. So fatty meals which increases the absorption of glycosylphosphatidylserine. So glycosylphosphatidylserine is an antifungal agent. So whenever the antifungal agent of glycosylphosphatidylserine is prescribed, so you have to take care of the fatty meals. Otherwise, the absorption rate will increase. Then next comes the presence of other drugs. So always, whenever more than one drug is prescribed, two or more drugs, so always there is a possibility of the changing in the absorption of other drugs or the same drug, whichever it is taken. So when there is more than one drug is there, then there is a possibility of the affection that is affecting the absorption of other drugs. Classical example is the ascorbic acid, which increases the absorption of oral ion. When you are aware, if you are taking the oral ion and ascorbic acid as a combination, you have to thinking about the dose of oral ion, because the ascorbic acid, which will increase the absorption of oral ion. Whereas, if you are taking the antacid with tetracycline, the antacids, which will decrease the absorption of tetracycline. So you have to increase the concentration of or the dose of tetracycline. So antacid, which will decrease the absorption of tetracycline. So like this, some drugs which will affect the absorption of other drugs. It may either increase or it may decrease. Then next comes the pharmacogenetic factors. So pharmacogenetic factors, in the sense there are certain genetic factors which may influence on the drug absorption. So classical example is in case of pernicious anemia, The vitamin B12, it is not absorbed in the gut due to the lack of intrinsic factor. You know very well the intrinsic factor is responsible for the absorption of vitamin B12 in the gut. But in case of pernicious anemia patients, so in their gene itself, there is a lack of intrinsic factor and there is a vitamin B12, they won't be absorbed. Then area of absorbing surface. So where the absorption exactly will take place, the better absorption is going to take place in the small intestine. So always the absorption, it is going to take place in small intestine because it has a larger surface area. But few people, the resection of gut, if they have been come across, that means the gut resection, if it is take place, so it will decreases the absorption because of reduced surface. Automatically, that is the resection means that is decreasing in the small intestine, the length of the small intestine. So automatically, that will be decreasing in the surface area, that rate of absorption also decreases. So the area of absorbing surface, which also affects the rate of absorption. At last, gastrointestinal and other diseases. So gastroenteritis. So in this case, it is a gastrointestinal disease, the gastroenteritis. In this particular cases, there is increasing in the peristaltic movement. When there is increasing in the peristaltic movement, there is a decreasing in the absorption rate of the drugs. In case of achlorhydria, there is a decreasing the absorption of ion in the gut. And in case of congestive cardiac failure, in case of congestive heart failure patients, so they will have the gastrointestinal mucosal edema. That is a retention of fluids. So gastrointestinal mucosal edema, which will decrease the absorption. So the gastrointestinal diseases, which will affect the rate of absorption of the certain drugs. And with that, I just want to conclude the session. Just go through it. What are the factors which may affect the rate of absorption?